Hi, this is Dr. Gregory Sadler. I'm a professor of philosophy and the president and founder of an educational consulting company called Reason.io, where we put philosophy into practice. I've studied and taught philosophy for over 20 years, and I find that many people run into difficulties reading classic philosophical texts. Sometimes it's the way things are said or how the text is structured, but the concepts themselves are not always that complicated, and that's where I come in. To help students and lifelong learners, I've been producing longer lecture videos and posting them to YouTube. Many viewers say they find them useful. What you're currently watching is part of a new series of shorter videos, each of them focused on one core concept from an important philosophical text. I hope you find it useful as well. Probably one of the most interesting features of this very short dialogue, the Crito, occurs in the last third of the dialogue, where Socrates brings in a third interlocutor, or third group of people talking. He's been talking with Crito up till this point, and he's, you know, talked about an imaginary person who would actually understand all these matters, but it's just him and Crito in the cell at that point. And then Socrates says, here's how I'm going to actually think my way through this. What if the laws of Athens were to come to me and say to me this? And these are the things that they would say. So Socrates is personifying the laws of Athens and imagining that and saying, look, Crito, the city itself, the laws, the constitution, the politeia, could say to me all of these sorts of things. How would I respond to that? Would they have a good claim against me? Or would I, in fact, be able to counter them in some way? As it's going to turn out at the very end, he says, I don't actually have a good response to these. They're right. It's interesting to think, although this takes us a little bit far afield, of, you know, who's actually doing the talking here? Is this Plato? Is this Socrates? Is this the city of Athens? How are we supposed to understand that? But here what we're going to do is concentrate more on what the laws are actually saying, and we're going to bring up a question that often comes up in relation to this, having to do with social contract theory, and then resolve it. But let's look at what the laws actually say first. So the laws show up, and they say, Socrates, you cannot violate the verdict. That's the central claim that the laws are making. That is, you cannot avoid the death sentence which we have sentenced you to. It would be wrong for you to do that. Why would it be wrong? You know, can't a person try to avoid that? We've already talked about that in other core concept videos having to do with this. Socrates says, no, you have to stand by your principles, and just because you're going to die doesn't mean you get to play fast and loose with them. But here the laws are actually saying, it would be wrong for you to violate the verdict. It would be wrong for you to make an exception for yourself. It would be wrong for you to take this opportunity that's been arranged by your friends, displaying, you know, courage and friendship and all that sort of stuff. That would be wrong for you to do. Here is why. And then they go down point by point by point why, in fact, he shouldn't do that. The first thing that they say is, think about this. What happens if any individual who wants to sets aside verdicts? What would be the case if more than one person did this? Socrates, you're doing the kind of action that destroys not only laws, but legal frameworks. The framework that other people have to live within. Societies. What the Greeks called constitutions, a politeia, the most fundamental laws of the state. You have to abide by these because if you don't, it's going to be chaos. And that sounds a little bit like social contract theory, which we'll come to towards the end of this and discuss it. And I'll tell you why it's not exactly social contract theory. But the laws are saying, look, you'd be attacking the city, you'd be making an exception for yourself. This is not the sort of thing that we can have if we want to actually have political order. A much more interesting argument, and the one that I think is actually at the heart of this, is you owe us. And you owe us sort of like you owe your parents.
except even more so. Why? Well, because the laws, the city, the framework that was created, is responsible for your very existence. The laws say, look, you didn't have a problem with the laws that regulate marriage and your parents coming together and made it possible for them to conceive you, do you? And Socrates says, no, I don't have any problem with that. And then what about your education? Socrates, remember, is a citizen, and he was educated. Mostly education was you know, very private back then, and it was arranged for. But the cities would have rules about, this is what counts as good paideia, education. This is what doesn't count as that. Here's what you have to do. Socrates is being told by the laws, we, in a way, have educated you. We're responsible for that. The kind of person that you are, the very fact that you are a person, the very fact that you exist, is due not only to your parents, but to us. Because guess who's responsible for your parents' existence and their parents' existence all the way through this sort of continuity? The laws, the city. This is what is often called an organic view of society or the state, where the state precedes the individual, and the individual has their existence in the framework of and because of the activity of the state, which precedes it. So he's saying, you owe us all of these things, and how do you pay back somebody that you owe? You can't even pay back your parents for your existence and your education. You're not going to be able to pay us back, so you should be doing the opposite of attacking us. You should be, you know, doing everything that you can to make sure that we stay in place, that, you know, we're rewarded in whatever way that you can do. The last thing that you ought to be doing is violating our edicts, you know? And they have an analogy there. They say, with a parent, and I think it's useful for you to remember that in the ancient Greek world, really the ancient world in general, parents had a sort of semi-divine status. A good son or daughter would not argue with parents, definitely would not strike them, would not be acting against them. So the notion here is, you're not supposed to attack your parents. You're not even allowed to attack your employer, because they're providing you with things that you need. So why are you attacking us when we have provided you with much greater benefits and blessings than your parents did? We provided the entire framework, your life world, so to speak. So I think that's a very interesting argument that's being made there, and it's a powerful one that Socrates seems to think is a good argument. Another one that he brings up, sort of ancillary to this, is, look, you had the opportunity to, and here's a key word, to persuade us. You had a trial. If you wanted to, you could have said, okay, I'll take exile rather than the death penalty. You had the choice to suggest that, or a fine. You could have defended yourself in a different way. You had the opportunity. You don't have the right to transgress our norms. But if you think that our norms aren't well-formed, or you think that they're not being applied fairly in this case, you can talk all you want. You have the opportunity to persuade us. In this case, it would have been persuading the members of the jury. But that's because Athens had, according to its laws, the right to a jury trial. And the way in which juries were conducted were, you know, regulated in accordance with these laws as well. So the laws say you had the opportunity to persuade us. As a matter of fact, if you didn't like what was going on, if you thought that something was unfair or was, you know, being done poorly, you're supposed to actually speak up. You didn't speak up. You thought everything was great until your friend Crito showed up with, you know, some money and a bribed guard and a ship ready to go. If you had problems, you should have registered them from the start, and you should have made an effort to change things through rational persuasion. So that's an interesting argument, too. Here's another really interesting one. I think this is another important one. If there are two arguments that are the most important, it's those two. The laws say to Socrates, you're a homebody. You talk about how great Sparta is, or Crete, and you like their constitutions. Why didn't you move there? If you think that their constitutions are better, we weren't going to stop you. We would actually let you take all of your property, your family, move to a colony if you wanted to. Athens had a lot of colonies. You could even move to one of the enemy cities. We don't care. Just so long as you understand that if you're staying here, you abide by our rules. You didn't do that, Socrates. You tacitly decided for our form of government, for what we were going to do. So by staying here this entire time, by choosing to stay in the city of Athens, you've placed yourself under us. You were under us anyway because we're responsible for your existence. But if you didn't like it, if you wanted to be an ingrate son of the city, you could have left, but you didn't do that. So you've reaffirmed that you actually agree with the way that we do things. If you had a problem with the death penalty being in existence, why weren't you protesting it? Why weren't you, finding ways to avoid it? Why weren't you persuading us not to apply it in this case? You didn't do any of those sorts of things. You chose to stay here. So by choosing to stay here, by choosing to accept the benefits of being in Athens, you chose to accept all of the obligations and all of the dangers that came with that, including possibly being sentenced to death if you violated our norms. Those are the two that are the most powerful arguments, I think. There's another one that's an afterthought, and I don't think that this is one that Plato or Socrates really takes that seriously, but it's thrown in there anyway. And you could ask, well, why is it thrown in there? Well, because Crito himself is the kind of guy that would find this convincing. You can realize that he is that way because he's making appeals like that at the start. So the laws say to Socrates, it wouldn't be any good anyway. And not at this point. If you wanted to leave before and take all of your property and possessions and even some of your friends and your family with you, that would have been just fine. But now that we've passed the verdict, you can't do that anymore. You lost the occasion for that. If you were going to go to another city, maybe they'll take you in, but maybe they won't. No good city is going to take you in. No city that's like Athens in having any decent laws. Why? Because you've already shown that you're going to violate a good city's laws. Why would they take you in? It would be sort of like, if we want to use some examples here, if you know that somebody's a thief, you don't let them into your treasury. You don't give them your credit card. If they've already robbed somebody else, why would you do that? If you know that somebody is prone to, this is something that happens all the time, if you know that somebody's prone to cheating, particularly because they cheated with you on, say, their spouse, why would you marry them? You know they're going to cheat on you. They've already established their character. And so the laws are saying this to Socrates, if you break our laws, if you attack us, if you violate the norms, other cities are going to look at that and they're going to say, we don't want that guy. He's going to do the same thing to us. He is an abuser. He is an exception maker. He is a transgressor. Now, you can go to some other city that's poorly governed, you know, where it's all license or arbitrariness or whatever you like, but that's not going to be like Athens, and you're not going to be happy there anyway because they're not going to provide you with these sort of benefits. Good laws aren't going to tolerate that sort of stuff. So that's the last argument. Now the question that remains open is Plato articulating something like a social contract theory? And my answer is actually no. I don't think that this is similar to modern social contract theory. You can say, well, there is that notion of, you know, tacit consent, and there is also that notion of, look, if you're attacking the legal framework, then, you know, it's all possible, you know, chaos or disorder. You never know what's going to happen. If you take away the laws, then we're all just sort of at each other's throat. It takes more than that to have social contract theory, though. You actually need to have some sort of agreement in place. Socrates made an agreement with the laws. He didn't make an agreement with his fellow citizens to abide by the laws. So it's not social contract theory in that sense. There's another important sense as well. The most fundamental laws in social contract theory are derived by human beings rationally working them out or deliberating, and those provide the basic framework. In this case, the basic framework is there. There's no discussion of where it came from, and they're actually independent of the rational subject, who then has to acknowledge their dependency on the framework that the laws have provided. So this, you know, more organic conception of society or the state, that's not the same thing as social contract theory. This argument right here, I think, really shows us that it's not social contract theory, whatever the other ones may offer. In any case, it's a fascinating passage where the laws themselves are being given voice by Socrates, by Plato in the dialogue, and they make all of these arguments. Like I said, some of them are stronger than others, but there they are.